Just to look at these announcements, the August 23rd, Daily Bread, 4 p.m., will need desserts. And then next Sunday, August 28th, there's a baptism service. And if anyone else wants to be baptized, let me know, and we'll work those details out. Also, we had the collection for the Kentucky flood victims, and we're packing things up today, it looks like. So we'll take care of that. And then next week, we're going to have a carry-in dinner before the baptism service, and I'm going to have Ada explain what we need from you.
We are going to have a carry-in meal here. We're going to have pulled pork sandwiches, and then drinks will be available. If you guys would like to bring any kind of salads, desserts, or chips, we're wanting to have it a light meal. Of course, we know when Grace Chapel meets, we don't eat light, but we'd like to try to have a light meal before the baptism, which will be at our house, but the meal and that will be here at the church after the service next Sunday.
All right, so we're looking forward to that. We're going to have a good time, I know, and we'll worship the Lord today. Did I ask anybody to do the opening prayer? If I didn't, Ken, would you like to do that for us?
Yes, Heavenly Father, we're gathered here together the first day of this new week to bring you praise and honor. Thank you, Lord, for the good things that you bring into our lives, and strength and health, and so much that we depend on you for. Father, ask your presence with us here this morning, as I know you are. May your Holy Spirit guide and direct us in our fellowship and our worship together. May we be ready to serve after meeting together here this morning. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Isabella, will you come and lead us in starting out worship?
Good morning. This is going to be a little different because I found a song that has been on my heart for a while and I've wanted to share it with all of you, but I could not find it without the other people like singing it, so to speak. So I'm going to play it for you guys, and I do ask like we stand still, and it'll have the words still. But I really wanted to share the song with all of you.
I call on Jesus. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right, let's turn our hymnals to hymn number 117.
Turn in your hymnal to number 28. We're going to do a responsive reading, and it's a scripture passage, and it's not real long, but this is something I like to do once in a while as we look at the scripture. So, 28, what I'll do is I'll read the light print. You respond by reading the dark print on number 28. We just sang about praising Him. And here are some words that give Him praise. Come, let us praise the Lord with our innermost being.
Praise His holy name.
Let us not forget all of His benefits.
He forgives all our sins.
He heals all our diseases.
He redeems our lives from the pit and crowns us with His love and compassion.
He satisfies our desires with good things.
So that our
God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Also at this time, I'm going to have a pastoral prayer. I want to go to the throne of grace and talk to Him. We've got several people with issues that are struggles that they're having physically, and we want to deal with those. One of the newest ones we know about is Lori, and she's going to have some major surgery. Am I right at that, Ed?
Yes.
Okay. And there's others, I'm sure. So I'm going to lead us in prayer, but if you feel like there's someone you really know has some struggles, if you're able and you want to come kneel at the altar for them or just come to the front row and sit, and I'll give you a chance to do that. This is new, I know. Didn't do this before, but we can do it now. And prayer is so important, so much a part of our lives as Christians, and we need to be praying people all the time. So if you want to move to a different position, if you don't, it doesn't look like anybody's moving. That's okay. So, I know. I guess I'm wrong. heart. Would you bow with me for prayer? Our Father and our God, we come here this morning and we are here to praise your name. You are the only true God. You have created the universe. You've created all things. And Father, you love us so much that you saw our sinfulness and you sent forth your Son who walked among us, lived among us, taught us many things, but he came so he could die in our place to be that Savior we so desperately need. And we thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he came, he lived, he died, he rose again to prove his power over sin and death. And you are working in our lives. Thank you for that today. Father, you know the hurts, the heartaches that some people are going through sitting here today. Father, you know them, and you may be the only one who knows what they're going through. But Father, we come before you because you are the God who works in the depths of our hearts. Whatever our trouble, whatever our struggle, that you are there with us. Lord Jesus walks beside us. The Holy Spirit is in us. And Father, we thank you for that. We pray that this morning, this time, we would sense your Spirit here, that we would do what glorifies you, not what honors us or glorifies us, but where you gain all the glory. And Father, touch the lives who are here, who are hurting. You're the one that can change those circumstances. You're the one that can give us strength as we go through those circumstances, because you are the awesome God and you deserve our praise. Father, thank you for being with us today. And I pray that every aspect of our service, I think you've already prepared our hearts as we started singing songs of praise, but you have so much more for us. So help us come with open minds, open hearts, ready to hear from you, expecting that you'll meet our need, whatever it is. And thank you for what you're doing in all of our lives. We ask this and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Let's turn our hymnals again to hymn number 210. And Isabel and I really don't know this song real well, so if you do, you sing out.
Before ever virgin dwelt among
Father, again we come before you to give you thanks, to give you praise, Lord. Lord, you've blessed us so greatly. And now, Lord, as we give back a portion of what you have blessed us with, we pray that you would take it and multiply it and use it for your kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Something new in our lives is just, how am I going to handle this? You know, it's like it's all the time anymore. So this song has a lot of meaning for me, especially right now. I'm only human, I'm just a man. Help me believe in what I could be and all that I am. Show me the stairway I have to climb. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today. Show me the way one day at a time. Do you remember when you walked among men? Well, Jesus, you know, if you're looking below, it's worse now than then. pushing and shouting that's crowded my mind. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking from you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking from you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time.
What a great Savior we have. All that He's done for us. What a great Savior. If you have your Bibles, we're going to look at a couple of verses that we've seen in the past few weeks in different contexts. It's in John chapter 4 is the verse I was looking at. It was verse 29, but we're going to get there. It'll take us a while to get there. And just to remind us where we've been, as we're doing this series on following Jesus, we started by identifying who Jesus was. John the Baptist says, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." And then the second one was meeting Jesus. It's one thing to know who He is, but you have to finally meet Him. And so we saw where these two disciples of John saw John point the next day at Jesus again. And so they took off and followed Jesus. They met Him. And then the third part we talked about was listening to Jesus. He's got something to say to us. And so we listen to what He has to say. And we went to chapter 3 of John and met Nicodemus and the conversation they had. And then finally, the last time that I was preaching, came to part 4, which is surrendering to Jesus, that you know who He is, you've met Him, and you've heard what He has to say, and so you respond to that by surrendering your life to Him. You give your life to Christ, and we talked about that, so that we can be born again. Well, today we're going to talk about the fact that we need to learn from Jesus. We've step 5 here, part 5, whatever we're going to call it. We need to learn from Jesus. And so I spent a lot of time thinking about teachers, and I know there's teachers here, and there's a story of a seminary professor by the name of Howard Hendricks, and he was a great teacher. He served in that seminary for more than 50 years, and his whole was Christian education and how to communicate truth. And one of his students was Bruce Wilkinson. I don't know if you remember the Prayer of Jabez guy. That's who that is. Or he also started Walk Through the Bible years before that. So he was telling a story about Howard Hendricks was such a great teacher that he really focused on giving the truth, but also trying to make sure everybody was catching it, understanding it. So a good teacher knows that the learner has to actually be learning something. And so Wilkinson said this. He said, every class that Hendricks taught, he started out with two or three minutes of little story, kind of a funny story usually, something, to get our attention. And then once he had our attention, then he started giving us the truth. So he said, I'm going to test this. Wilkinson said, I'm going to test this. He said, I'm going to go and I'm going to sit and look out the window when he starts. So Wilkinson's sitting in his chair, looking out the window. Howard Hendricks gets up, he starts talking, he starts sharing this story. He's walking back and forth, and his eyes keep coming over to Wilkinson, looking out the window. And he even come close to him to give the punchline or whatever else. And then finally he says, "Wilkinson, what's so important out there that you're looking at?" And he said, "I didn't tell him. I just, oh, okay, I'm back here." But he said he was concerned about somebody learning. A teacher that teaches well is concerned about the student who's learning. And Jesus is the greatest teacher. And that's what he wants us to learn. And so he gives examples of people who he's been teaching. So in chapter 3 of John, turn back there, we saw this. And I'm just going to identify him as the teacher. And there's four different categories I'm going to list here. And one is, we're going to look at the teacher. We're going to look at the teaching, what's being taught. The learner, the one who's trying to learn. And the learning, what he has actually learned. And so this process we're going to think about. Because we all need to know more and more about Jesus and what he wants to know. So in chapter 3, that's where we had the story of Nicodemus. And then simply verse 2, it says, "This man," that's Nicodemus, "came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.'" And so Nicodemus has heard about Jesus. He's seen evidences of what he does, and he knows that he's doing miraculous things, and only God could do that. So he comes, and some people say, "Well, he came at night because he was a Pharisee, didn't want any of the Pharisees to know this." But more than likely, Jesus is surrounded by people all the time. He wanted some alone time with Jesus, and that was the only time he could get there. So he comes, and he makes this statement, "We know you're a teacher come from God. And you've got stuff I need to know." So here, the learner is Nicodemus. He has a desire to know something. Jesus is the teacher, and so he comes as a student coming to the teacher. But farther down in chapter 3, down to verse 10, we have this statement by Jesus. He says, "Jesus answered and said to him, 'Are you the teacher of Israel and do not know these things?'" And he just talked about being born again, the necessity of a spiritual birth, not just a physical birth, but a spiritual birth to have a relationship with the living God. And so he points out he's a teacher. And if we drop down a little farther in John chapter 3, down at verse 13, here's the teaching that Jesus is the teacher. Here's an example of what he's teaching. There's so many stories in Scripture where Jesus is teaching someone. We're just pulling it right here when we're looking at this Nicodemus. And so he starts telling a bunch of different things. So in verse 13, it says, "No one has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is the Son of Man who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." And so Jesus, in teaching Nicodemus, who should know the Old Testament scriptures frontward and backward, he turns to a story in the Old Testament about Moses. And we're scratching our heads saying, and maybe Nicodemus did too, "What in the world are you talking about? You know, ascended from heaven, lifted up a serpent in the wilderness, what's all that stuff?" Well, you know, the Old Testament has a story about that. It's found in Numbers chapter 21 and verses 4 through 9. I'll just read this. If you're going to look at it, you can look it up in your Bible. So Numbers 21, and it happens that this is when the children of Israel are wandering in the wilderness and they're not happy. Things aren't as good as they thought they were going to be. They're starting to remember some of the good food they had back in Egypt and all this stuff. So it says, and I'm picking up in the middle of the story, verse 4 says, "Then they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to go down to the land of Edom. And so it's they're wandering around and they're not happy. And it goes on and says, "The soul of the people became discouraged on the way." Anybody have ever been discouraged? Maybe yesterday, maybe this morning. All right. And so as they're traveling, they say, well, this is kind of a rotten deal we have here. We're always wandering around, no place to, you know, stop and get some, you know, good food or nothing else. And it says they're upset. Verse 5 goes on, and this is probably not what they wanted, but God heard them complain, and he gave them what they needed. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. And so they're complaining so much as, what's this Moses done for us lately? How's come he didn't do this? And why hasn't God shown up again? Why? What's going on here? I think we made the wrong turn somewhere. This can't be good. Well, that's my, you know, sanctified imagination, but anyway. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? This is miserable. For there's no food and no water, and our soul loathes this worthless bread. Whoa, what? Every day God sends bread from heaven, and you say it's loathsome, worthless? Man, they're stepping on shaky ground. Because God has protected them, has stood by them, has brought them out of slavery, bringing them into a new wonderful land that he's promised. And they don't like the trip. Are we there yet? Ever hear that? Ever said that? Are we there yet? Yeah. Verse 6. So the Lord, this is what they didn't want. The Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and many of the people of Israel died. Ouch. We ought to think twice about complaining about what God has put in our life, but he'll certainly talk to us about it if we want to. Therefore, I think the complaining probably stopped. Therefore, verse 7, the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned. Okay, we've sinned. We have spoken against the Lord and against you. We were wrong. That's a good place to start. Confession, admission, we've sinned. So pray to the Lord that he would take away the serpents from us. So Moses prayed for the people. Confession. We have done wrong. Please forgive us. Take away this horrible thing. So Moses prayed for the people. Verse 8, then the Lord said to Moses, make a fiery serpent, set it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, that serpent on the pole, when he looks at it, shall live. So Moses made the bronze serpent, put it on a pole, and so it was if the serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. If you look, you live. So Nicodemus is hearing this reminder of this story, and he maybe is rehearsing this, or he went to his Bible and looked up the story, whatever, but he knew this story. And it is a story about faith. Look and live. And if someone was bitten and says, how is it going to, looking at that stupid pole, what's going to, that's not going to do anything. How is that going to do anything? So, boom, I'll just die. But the people took God at his word. He said, if you'll look, you will be saved from this serpent. If a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. They believed God's word. God said, look, they looked, they believed, they're saved. Why would Jesus reference that as a teacher, talking to a teacher of Israel that would know this story? And it goes back and we look at it again, and what he says is, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. You look to Jesus Christ, and it doesn't matter what your background, what your sin, what your lifestyle, all those things that might be in opposition of who God is and what he wants. If you look to Jesus, invite him to be your Savior, he will come in and he'll transform your life and you will be saved. So Jesus, as he talked about the new birth, has this story about the serpent, has us go back and think about what happened with Moses. If they would look, they would live. If you look at Jesus Christ, you surrender your heart to him, you will be saved. You'll become a child of the living God. And that is some really, really good news. The writer of Hebrews says this in chapter 12, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. So that's the teacher giving a lesson. And here's an example of the teaching. Another example of the teachings in chapter 4. Flip over a page. John chapter 4. And we have the story of the woman at the well. I think most of you, many of you, know this story, know some of the details of this story. But it's another opportunity of teaching because he's going to teach someone new in this chapter. He taught Nicodemus in the last chapter. He's going to talk about this Samaritan woman who doesn't have the same connections that Nicodemus had, but she was a totally different person, but she's going to be someone that Jesus comes to teach. And she goes on, and we have this conversation about you. Who are you? What are you talking to me for? You don't have a bucket. How can you draw water? And you talk about this living water and never thirsting again. And so he said that in verse 16. He says, if anyone has this water that I give, it will lead to everlasting life. And all of a sudden, the light bulb went off in this lady's mind. And in verse 15, it goes this way. It says, the woman said to him, sir, give me this water. You see, a learner identifies himself with the willingness to learn when they ask the question, give me what you're talking about. I need that. I want to know that. I want to understand that. So the woman said to him, sir, give us this water that I may not thirst nor come here to drink or draw. I'm ready for that stuff. How do I get this water? What I got to do? And Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. And I'm thinking, she's saying, huh? What? What's that got to do with this conversation we're having? And the woman answered, I have no husband. And Jesus said to her, you have well said, I have no husband. For you've had five husbands. And one, the one you now have, is not your husband. In that you spoke truly. And the woman said to him, sir, I perceive you're a prophet. How does he know me? I never met this guy. He's not from around here. How would he know my life? How would he do this? Here's something amazing about this guy. See, the learner desires to know something, and all of a sudden she's put on the spot. Give me this water. Give me this water. We saw Nicodemus, you're a teacher come from God. Jesus says you must be born again, gives us an example of everybody looking up to him, to Jesus. If you flip back to chapter 3, I'm going to skip the one verse everybody knows, verse 16, we're going to go down to 17. And here's the thing they've learned. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. Did he condemn the woman at the well? No. All he did was affirm her. It says, what you've told me is true. Not that I want to verify or some kind of agreement that your lifestyle is something I would approve. I'd have nothing to do with that, but I'll tell you this. Those of us who have sinned against God, have rebelled against God, usually no one has to tell us what we've done wrong. because God's Holy Spirit's already banging on our heart saying this is wrong. What they need is an understanding that God wants to transform your life so you don't have this guilt and pain and you can be free. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Just being in Jesus' presence brings conviction to your heart. And he goes on later in this few verses down about the darkness we're in and trying to escape the light and so forth. But the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And so, Jesus is the teacher. Nicodemus is the learner. And what he's taught, what he's understanding, is Jesus is making very clear, you got to believe in me. You're already condemned. You've already made those choices. But you need to believe in me because I've come to rescue you and change you and give you a new life. That's what being born again means as Jesus talks about his need for faith. And then if you go back to our other example in chapter 4 again, you want to flip back there. The learning takes place when she says, I perceive you're a prophet. I just learned something from you by the way you responded to me. I learned that you're a prophet. You know things that only God knows about me or this town. And then also down in verse 24, at the end of their conversation, it says, God is spirit. Jesus says, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. And then the woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming. I know that Messiah is coming. He was called Christ. And when he comes, he will tell us all things. She's learned some things already. He's a prophet. And so she shares things that she's learned before, that there is a Messiah coming. Even the Samaritans are waiting for this Messiah. You Jews think about it this way, we think about it that way, but we believe there's a Messiah coming. And when he comes, he's going to straighten everything out. And she didn't expect to hear this next statement in verse 26. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. You're looking at the Messiah. You're looking at the Messiah. Look and live. And as we get down through the rest of this story, we drop down to verse 29. His disciples came back from town, brought him food, but they see him talking to this woman. They're confused about what's all going on there. They don't understand what's going on. Verse 29, it says, or verse 28 says, the woman left her water pot, went her way into the city and said to the men, come see a man who told me all things that ever I did. Could this be the Christ? Look and live. Hey, you guys need to come meet this guy. You got to see this guy. And so the townsfolk run out to see this Jesus. And it says in verse 39, and many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified, he told me all that ever I did. And they believed just hearing her story. They believed in this Jesus. And he comes back later and says, now it's not just because of what you said, but we saw him, we heard him, we talked to him, he's staying a couple days there doing the right thing. There are learners, people that want to learn. And if you're here and you want to learn from Jesus Christ, I hope that every time we're together you learn something more. And I learned something more. There are teachers. I'm going to I get a time I'm going to share this one last illustration, and it's we're going to end with this, but it's in Luke chapter 24. And I'm just going to pick some verses out and read them as I give you this story. In Luke chapter 24, it's Jesus Christ has died and rose again. He's alive. And there's been all these things talking, and two of his disciples come from town talking on their way to a place called Emmaus, and they're talking about, they're so confused about the testimonies of the women that said he wasn't there and the tomb was open and there was no him. And then someone said that, you know, that they actually saw Jesus walking around, and they're having this discussion. In verse 13 and 14, it says, "Now behold, two of the men were traveling, and they talked together of all these things that happened." They're having this conversation. They're wanting to know something. They are learners wanting to know something. And then down in verse 15, it says, here comes the teacher. "So it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them." So they're talking about all that's happened. They don't understand it. They need someone to tell them what's going on. And all of a sudden, the teacher shows up. He just kind of slides in and walks along with them. And he said to them, so teacher, part of the teaching is the ability to ask questions. Jesus asked a lot of questions. And he said to them, verse 25, "O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe." Or excuse me, 20, I got way ahead of myself. Verse 15. "So it was while they conversed and reasoned, they came together and he went with them." And so they explained, "What, you don't know what's going on? Where are you coming from? How's come you know what we're talking about?" "Well, just tell me. I don't know what you're talking about." And so he has this conversation, which then leads down to verse 25. And he said to them, after they've got all this stuff, "We just don't understand. It doesn't make any sense. We thought he was going to be the Messiah. We thought he was going to lead us into to freedom from the Roman Empire. We thought he was going to do all this stuff for us. And he died on the cross and he was buried. And now they said the tomb's empty and we're confused. It doesn't make any sense." And Jesus says in verse 25, "Then he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things? Don't you know? The real Messiah, the Christ, it predicted that he had to suffer. He had to go through all these things. He had to face those things. That Christ ought to suffer these things and to enter into his glory. Then he could go back to his glory." John 17 has this whole prayer with Jesus talking to the Father, talking about, I'm ready to finish stuff here, and I'm looking forward to being up with you again, Father, as I was before in eternity past. "And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." The learner wants to know. "I'm confused." The teacher wants to teach, to give you the truth. And so he starts to go through all the Old Testament stories, maybe even did the one that he shared with Nicodemus. We don't know. It's not recorded for us. But it was all about him, the Messiah, and how they could believe. The learners are there. The teacher's there. He teaches them all these things from Moses and the prophets of the Old Testament. And then the learning process kicks in verse 30. "Now it came to pass," you know, they said, "Come on, have dinner with us, come to our house, we'd like to hear more." So he came. "And it came to pass as he sat with them at table that he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were open." It's Jesus. He's been with us all this time. "Their eyes were open and they knew him. And then he vanished out of sight." Oh, we saw Jesus. He is the Messiah. He had to suffer. He told us what it all meant. He died in our place. He took our sin to the cross with him. He gave us new life by our faith in him. "And they said to one another," I love this, "did not our heart burn within us? While he talked to us on the road, and while he opened the scripture to us." Can you imagine letting Jesus open the scripture and you get to hear exactly what it means from the author of the book? You know, that's why he's given us the Holy Spirit. So when we open up that book and we ask for his help and his guidance. We've got someone that can help us right here by us. We need to learn from Jesus. And the best place to find out what he's got to say is in this book. Are we learning from Jesus? Are we seeking to know him better? Are we following Jesus in all these little steps that I've been talking about? I believe as we do that, our faith grows stronger. Our peace grows greater because there's a lot of things to worry about. But let that worry go on the shoulders of Jesus Christ and he will see us through whatever it needs to be. He's here with us today. Whatever you're struggling with, he's here. He loves you. He loves me. And he's ready to work in our lives. We need to keep allowing him to do that. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the things you're teaching us. And Father, in the days and weeks ahead, we pray that we will be receptive students, that will come with questions, and will ask you to unexplain these things to us, and your Holy Spirit can do that in our lives. Father, I just thank you for your love for us. As we come and we sing this song together, help us give ourselves to you. And if anyone needs to come to the altar, let them feel free to do so. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's be standing and turn our hymnals to hymn number 223. Oh, how he loves you and me. Loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life, what more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Jesus to Calvary did go, his love for sinners to show. What he did there brought hope from despair. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time you've given us together, Lord. Thank you for the words you've sent to our pastor, Lord. And help us to just trust you, Lord, with anything that comes into our lives, and we just lean on you. If we have sin in our lives, Lord, help us to have the courage to confess it to you so you may be able to forgive us. Lord, just take everything we've learned today out into life with us out throughout this week, Lord, and we may extend it to our families and our friends and lead others to know you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Maybe seated, and anybody else, something you want to share? Time is up to do that.